Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to the webinar Be Safe on Cyberspace, going to be delivered by the Gajendra Deshpande sir from KLS Gokte Institute of Technology, Belagavi, India. Giving introduction to this research person is delivered many lectures or technical speaks in many different countries like US, France, and UK. Virtually, he even participated in many international conferences and spoken on many technical aspects. He virtually attended in many different countries like Indonesia, Australia, Africa, Thailand, and many more. So I just want to welcome him, Gajendra sir. I even thank our HOD sir, Raj Purohit sir, for providing such a good opportunity, and even KLS principal sir, Jayan Kittur sir, and the management members. I hand over the session to the today's resource person, Gajendra Deshpande sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Raghavendra sir, for providing my introduction. Yeah. So today and tomorrow I will be speaking on the topic how you can be safe on cyberspace. Actually, we had planned this webinar in the month of October because October month is celebrated as a cyber safety month. But due to some other commitments, we were not able to schedule it in the month of October. So we have scheduled this talk today and tomorrow, that is 4th and 5th November. So in today's webinar, we are going to discuss some cyber crime statistics, then passwords, what's a good password and a strong password, what are the tools to check the strength of your password, then emails, do's and don'ts, then how you can be safe on a social media platform like Facebook, then what are the guidelines to be safe on instant messaging tools like WhatsApp and Telegram, and how you can download files safely on the internet. Then finally, the safety tips for using ATM. So some cybercrime statistics here. The Internet Crime Report for 2019, released by United States of America's Internet Crime Complaint Center, it's also known as IC3, of Federal Bureau of Investigation, has revealed that India stands third in the world among top 20 countries that are victims of internet crimes. So you can also see some numbers there. In 2018, in USA, there were more than 450,000 cyber crimes reported. In UK, it is more than 90,000, and in India, it is more than 25,000. But note here that these numbers are only reported numbers. Every day, there are lot many people in India and also in the world who are victims of internet crimes. And according to RSA, RSA is a company which looks after the security. It's a company in security domain. According to RSA report of 2015, mobile transactions are rapidly growing and cyber criminals are migrating to less protected soft channels. So note here that your handheld devices like mobiles, they are treated as soft channels because till today, not many people are aware of mobile phones or smartphone settings. So most people use their mobile phone with the default settings, and they grant permissions to the applications installed on the installed on their phones. So this makes it a soft target. The next, according to the report by Norton of 2015, an estimated 113 million Indians lost about 16,558 rupees on an average to cybercrime. It's a huge number. And according to an article published in Indian Express on 19th November 2016, over 55% millennials in India are hit by cybercrime. So millennials are those people who are born after 1995. So our younger generation is hit by cybercrime badly. In today's talk, we are going to discuss few tips, few tools and few guidelines regarding how to be safe on internet. The first important aspect is the passwords. So in passwords, we know that whatever applications we use on the internet, you need a password to use those applications. And note here that you should be setting the strong password. In the next slide, I will be discussing how to set a strong password and what are the different tools and some guidelines. You should never set a weak password, and there are tools to actually determine whether the password is a strong password or a weak password. Most of the applications you use, they have inbuilt tools. The moment you start typing the password, they will indicate whether your password is strong or weak or medium. Even if it is not there, then they say that to set the strong password, you must have a combination of lowercase letters, uppercase letters, special characters, digits, and so on. So you should be using all those characters and create a strong password. Then one more important feature is two-factor authentication. So you can either link your mobile phone or email ID so that you get some a secret code, 4-digit or 6-digit code. So once you enter those codes, you will be given access to your application's dashboard. So see here that two-factor authentication is the additional security which you need to configure apart from your password. Okay. And it is better that you use your personal mobile phone and not any other person's phone for two-factor authentication, and never leave your mobile phones. Then next, some applications, if they don't provide two-factor authentication, they provide sometimes one-time login. So in one-time login, what happens is, if you select this option, password will come to your email ID or mobile number, and whatever password you receive, you need to enter that code. It is basically passwordless system. Each time you are going to get a new password to your email ID or mobile number. Now the example for two-factor authentication is your Gmail. So Gmail provides the facility of two-factor authentication, whereas Hotmail uses one-time login. Then next is social engineering. Why I have included this term here is, everybody speaks about strong password. It may be the world's strongest password, but it can be hacked in seconds. So basically in cryptography, we speak about the strength of the password, strength of the key, and we say that if password is complex, if it is not a dictionary word, if it is a combination of uppercase letters, lowercase letters, digits, special letters, and also the password with great length can secure you. But that is not the case. With social engineering, you can hack any password within seconds. So social engineering is a technique using which we gather or hackers gather the information. So they collect information about the target, say for example organization or a person, then their details like their date of birth or date of formation, key people, right? After collecting the information, they frame the attack vector, and that can be used to crack any password. So no password is secure. So don't just go by computing terms. Okay, you can set a strong password. I will show the strength of the password, and it shows that to break a password so many years are required. But don't believe those things, because that can be hacked in very less time using social engineering techniques. I can also call an organization and pretend that I am a legitimate officer, and I can try to collect all the information, and that can be hacked. So you might have heard that many people are losing money from their savings account or from their bank account. So basically how it works is you will receive a call, and some person on the other side says that he is a bank representative and he needs so and so data. That is, he will collect your card number, CVV, and also the OTP. Once you provide it, he will just enter those details and he will transfer the amount to your account. So this is the best example for social engineering. Okay. So however secure your system may be, but the person who is expert in social engineering tactics can hack it. Okay. Now there's a very wonderful website. So you can note down this website. I will also show some demonstrations here. It's known as haveibeenpwned.com. So if you visit this website, you just enter your email account, and it will show on what all websites you have registered and whether the password is compromised. So let's see the demo of this website. So I'll just open haveibeenpwned.com. Some errors. Google. So haveibeenpwned.com. So this is the user interface. So what I'll do is I will just enter my email account, and I'll click on pwned button. So it says that I have registered on many websites and my password has been compromised on 10 websites. Okay, so it shows that 10 breached websites. Okay, so for example, you can see here on the screen, this password, this email account's password was compromised on 000 web host, then on Adobe, then on Check, then on exploit.in, on iMesh, on Linux forums, on Netlog, and on Tundu. So on many websites, on almost 10 websites, this email account's password has been pawned. That means it has been compromised. Okay, so what hackers do is they hack the database of these service providers and they sell it in the dark web. So other hackers, what they do is they just simply buy these databases and use the password and use it for their advantage. Okay. Then next, you can also check whether your password is compromised. Okay. So I will enter my password here and I will check whether it is compromised. Yeah, so I have entered my password. So it says that this password has been seen 47 times before. That means this has been compromised. Okay, so if you want to set a new password, then just come to this site and check whether that has been already compromised. Okay, so say for example, I will enter here one more password. Yeah, so now it says that no pawnage found. That means this password is safe. Okay, this password is secure. So this is the way you can check whether your password has been compromised, whether hackers have access to your password. Okay, then next, there is one more website by Kaspersky. So that is password.kaspersky.com. So you can check the strength of your password. So let's say for example, I will enter my password here. Yes, now you can see here that it is giving me the message that time for password change. Your password is easily crackable. Password is a common or a word. So you cannot choose any dictionary words or common words. If you choose them, then definitely hackers will be having the access to the compromised passwords and it can be easily hacked. So with computer, you can hack it in 3 days. Okay. Let me enter one more password. So now I have entered a long password. Now you can see here that it says nice password. Your password is hack resistant. Your password does not appear in any database of leaked passwords. Okay. Now it will take approximately 7167 centuries if hackers try to hack it with brute force approach. So that's why brute force approach will never work while cracking the passwords. So that's why hackers rely on social engineering techniques. So if they use social engineering techniques, instead of 7000 plus centuries, they can just hack it in 7 days maybe. Okay, so that's the power of social engineering tactics. They will collect the information about me, my activities, the things around me, and frame attack vector and hack it. Okay, so just you can spend this time walking to the moon and back 7000 centuries. Okay, yeah. Then next, this is also a nice website that is known as passwordmeter.com. So you can see here there are many aspects mentioned: number of characters, uppercase letters, lowercase letters, numbers, symbols, middle numbers or symbols, plus the requirements. And also there are some other things are mentioned, that is letters only, numbers only. That means these things you should not have. Okay, the things which are mentioned in green color, you should not have. If you include them, then it will contribute towards the strength of the password negatively. So you should consider things which are mentioned in red color, in cross mark. Okay, so you can also see here there is a parameter called as rate. So if you include more number of uppercase characters, then the strength of your password will be more. Okay, and it does not depend on the length of the password. Okay, so let's see what will the score of my two passwords. So first I will enter my long password. So you can see here I have entered my long password. It says that score is 57% and complexity is good. It's a good password. But you can see here there are some things which are affecting the strength of my password. So they are repeated characters, consecutive lowercase letters and consecutive numbers. So these are the parameters which are affecting the strength of my password. Okay. Whereas there are other things which are contributing positively to the strength of my password. Of course, I have not included any symbols. I have not included any uppercase letters. Okay. Now let me enter another password. So now you can see here that I have entered relatively shorter password, but the score is now 73%. Okay. So just the length of the password does not contribute to the complexity of the password or strength of the password. It is the combination of different characters which will actually contribute to the strength of the password. Okay. So these are the some of the websites. So you can use these websites and you can set good passwords for your accounts. Now again, let me switch back to my slides. So after seeing those tools, let us discuss what's a good password and a strong password. So you need to use at least 8 characters or more to create a password. Even if you use 8 characters, that is fine, but you should use the combinations of different letters and characters. The more number of characters we use, the more secure is our password. This may not be true in all cases because we have already seen the demonstration. So apart from length of the password, even the combination of different types of characters plays very, very important role. Then use various combinations of characters while creating a password. For example, create a password consisting of a combination of lowercase, uppercase, numbers and special characters, etc. Avoid using the words from a dictionary. They can be cracked easily. It is not only the dictionary, any standard list. For example, list of school names, list of person names, list of vegetables, list of fruits, okay, list of cities, list of countries. Okay, so all these standard lists you should avoid. Then create a password such that it can be remembered. This avoids the need to write passwords somewhere which is not advisable. For example, in case of system generated passwords, if we generate a password from a system, then it will be a long password, and since characters are arranged randomly, you cannot by heart it or you cannot remember it. Okay, so that's why you should use such a password which can be remembered, but it should have all those features of a strong password. Then a password must be difficult to guess. As I have already told you, hackers will try to gather information about you using social engineering techniques. So you can try to set a password which is not at all related to your personality, maybe. Okay, then change the password once in 2 weeks or when you suspect someone knows the password. Okay, so the best thing is to check Have I Been Pwned website, that is HIBP website, and check whether your password is there in the database of leaked passwords. Do not use a password that was used earlier. That's why many banks or credit card service providers or even Amazon, they maintain the list of previous 5 passwords. Even Facebook maintains the previous 5 passwords. Okay, so if you try to enter any of those passwords, they will just disallow it. Then be careful while entering a password when someone is sitting beside you. So see that they are not observing what you are typing. Do not use the name of things located around you as passwords for your account. Don't set your pet's name as a password. Don't set your spouse's name or your girlfriend or boyfriend's name as password. Okay. So don't set any objects or any favorite movies or whatever, any favorite people's names. Don't set these things as password, because these can be easily cracked using social engineering techniques. Then after passwords, the next important thing is emails. So you might have noticed that you get such type of fake emails. So the best thing is just ignore them. Okay, so here it's a email related to financial fraud, saying that there is a person out of India who has to settle a huge amount of money, and he is seeking your help, and if you help him, then they may give you some sort of percentage as a sharing. So you just need to ignore such emails. And there are some other kinds of emails. For example, they say that they have your confidential information or private information, and if you don't transfer the amount, they will just simply share that information with the public or with your friends. So if you don't have anything related to that, just ignore those things. Even if you have it, just ignore it, because it is not at all related to you. Okay, then this is another type of email. So whatever emails you are seeing here on the screen, these are the emails which I have got in my email account. Okay, so you can see here that it says that your Apple ID has been locked. Sometimes you will also see that your Amazon ID or PayPal ID has been locked. Click here to reset it. Okay, now you can see here in this email, there's a link called as verify your account. Okay, so in verify account, don't click on it. So although this mail appears legitimate, but it is not legitimate. There are many signs here which will clearly tell that this is a fake email. First thing, check from whom the mail is coming. Okay, it is not from Apple. It is something from fizgee.com. Okay, this is not at all from Apple. So first thing, very important, is you should see this official apple.com. I am not seeing it. So it is clearly a fake email. Then next, even if you see that it's a mail from apple.com, because it is very easy nowadays to send a fake email which appears that the sender is legitimate. So in that case also, don't directly click on any of the links. So in that case, what you should do is, if you are suspecting that that particular email is fake email, then just place your mouse cursor over the link. Don't click on it. So you just need to place the mouse cursor and observe the status bar in the window at the bottom of the window. Okay, so it will show the URL. Okay, otherwise one more thing what you can do is right click on the hyperlink, copy the link address, paste it in Notepad and see whether it is directing you to the official site. If it is directing you to official site, yes, you can consider it that it's a legitimate email and you can proceed. But generally, no service provider will send you that kind of email. But if it is not legitimate, then just ignore it. Don't do anything. Okay, just ignore that email. Don't reply. You can simply delete it. That is possible, but don't click on the link. So this is how you can check whether the link is from the legitimate website or a fake website. You should never click on the link. Then some do's and don'ts related to emails here. So use email filtering software to avoid spam so that only messages from authorized users are received. Most email providers offer filtering services. Okay, so you can use filtering services, search services here. So generally now most of the email service providers, they have inbuilt filter. That filter will classify whether the message is spam or ham, that is spam or legitimate email. So many times it also happens that if the email server detects that from a particular email account continuously mails are being sent, then it may even classify legitimate email as a spam email. So in that case, what you should be doing is you should also keep checking your junk mail or spam folder also for regular mails, because it is possible that even the legitimate email may go into junk folder or spam folder. So in that case, click on the legitimate email, then you can always add to safe senders list. So once you add that to safe senders list, that email will start appearing in the inbox instead of junk mail or spam folder. Okay. Now you may also see that there are some spam messages being sent continuously. You can go to email filters option and block them, or you can also set them to be deleted. Okay, so this exercise you need to do frequently, maybe whenever you have a time or at least once a month. The next, do not open attachments coming from strangers since they may contain a virus along with their received messages. Okay, if you don't know that person, then don't open any message from that particular person. You can open a message, but don't download any attachments, because that attachment may contain a virus or a malware or a spyware, etc., etc. Then next, be careful while downloading attachments from emails into your hard disk. Scan the attachment with updated antivirus software before saving it. So now most of the email service providers, they have inbuilt antivirus also, but it is better that you also scan it on your system before downloading it. If you are 100% sure, then only download it, otherwise just delete it or don't download it. Don't download it at the first place. Then do not send messages with attachments that contain executable code like Word documents with macros, then exe files, zipped files, etc. So we can use rich text format instead of standard doc format. So in that case, the file name will be .rtf. So you can achieve it using MS Word also. Otherwise, there is a software called as WordPad. You can save your files using RTF. So RTF files, it is not possible to include any macros. Macros are executable codes which can be included in your Word files or in your Excel files to automate the tasks in those documents. Okay, even if it is a legitimate document, then only you can download it. Otherwise, don't download any file with macros. This may prevent you from sending a virus to others if you are already infected by it. So it is possible that you can write a virus program using macros and embedded it in MS Word. The moment somebody opens MS Word file, that virus will affect your entire system, or it may also corrupt your Word file or Excel file. Damages are unpredictable. Avoid sending personal information through emails. Okay, never send any personal information through emails. Then avoid filling forms that come via email asking for you to enter your personal information, and do not click on links that come via email. So I have already explained in the previous slide how you can verify that the link is from the legitimate website without clicking on it. Then do not click on the emails that you receive from untrusted users, as clicking itself may execute some malicious code and spread into your system. Okay, so you should open emails only from the trusted source. The next is social networking. So we know that most of the people, especially our millennial generation or the people who are born after 1995, they are very active on social networking sites. And the present trend, what we see here, is even our senior citizens are on social networking sites nowadays. So they may not be aware of different settings. They may not be aware of different settings which are available on those websites. Okay, so you should, so it is our duty to safeguard our millennials as well as our senior citizens. So we should make aware of different settings available on those websites so that they can be safe on those websites. Now the important thing here is that everything is permanent and your social profile is an extension of yourself. So be cautious, be sensible. So that means once the information is created on the internet, it is permanent. You don't have a choice to delete it. Okay. So you may say that I'm deactivating the account, but or I'm deleting my profile picture. No, because there are many websites which are actually replicating many sites. Okay, if you upload video on YouTube today, that will be replicated on multiple websites after some days. So even if you delete the video from YouTube, it will be still available on other sites. Okay, so this happens automatically. There are many people who write automated scripts. So once you put any information on the internet, it is permanent. So you at least you cannot delete the your account on Facebook. You can just deactivate it. Now whatever you post online are permanent. So this includes texting. Private is not always private. So this is very, very important statement. So you can make your profile private. Okay, you can set that only these people can see my content, see my posts, photos, etc. Okay, but once it is posted, then it is gone. Then it is no longer private. Okay, because that will be stored in the database, and if any hacker hacks it, even though your profile settings are private, they have your information. The photo you post online is not owned by you anymore. So the rights of photo get transferred to the social channel once it is uploaded. So these things will be clear when you read the terms and conditions on those websites at the time of account creation. Same is the case with your paper publications. The moment you upload your paper, you upload your research paper, the moment you present your research paper in the conference, you are actually transferring your copyright to them. Okay, only in case of open source world there is a facility of keeping copyright with you. Okay, then next, every choice you make reveals your character. So you should be very careful on what you post on the social networking sites, because your social media sites or your Facebook profiles or your other social profiles will be viewed by many people. For example, it may be viewed by your prospective employer. It may be viewed by your prospective bride or a groom. Okay. So, by seeing your social media profile, they will make some picture about you in their mind. Then they start to visualize your character. So you should be very careful on what you share on the social networking sites. The next, try to be kind, not popular. Okay, so you can have interaction with the people. Don't use abusive words. Okay, so don't share too much content. Then social media should supplement your relationships and not replace them. Okay, it is very, very important. You might have heard of several stories related to it. Then what's not safe on social networking sites like Facebook or LinkedIn? So share personal information online. Personal information includes full name, date of birth, home address, school address, email, parents' details, etc. These things should not be on your social media profiles. Okay, so Facebook provides lock profile picture, lock profile facility. So lock your profiles. So people who are not on your friends list, they will not be able to see any content, even the posts. Okay, so you will be blocking people who are not in your network unless they become your friends. And even if they become friends, you can keep many information with yourself, or you can choose not to enter there. Then post pictures of yourself and others online. So never post pictures. Even if you post, you should select which one. So don't put actually the pictures. That's the guideline. Then talk with strangers online and offline. So this is true even in case of offline. So if you know that person, then only talk, otherwise don't talk. Then share location online to strangers. So you should never share your location to strangers. So these are the things which you should not do using social media websites. Then there are some potential risks with respect to social networking sites. Then exposure to harmful or inappropriate content. So we don't know what the other person is doing. Okay, so if you have a doubt on that person's profile, block them. Then exposure to dangerous people. We don't know what kind of people are there on the internet. They may be even cyber criminals, right? So it's not that to view the information about a person, they should be your in friend circle. Okay, there are settings like friends of friends also can view the information. Okay, so in that case, even if they are not your friends, they will be able to see a lot of information about you. Then cyberbullying, a risk factor for depression and suicide. Okay, so note here that bullying is there offline. So similar kind of bullying is also there online. So because of that, many people have lost their lives. Then oversharing personal information. Okay, don't share your personal photos or events photos, etc. Okay, so be selective. Exposure to excessive advertisements. Okay, so you will see a lot of advertisements. So based on your browsing history, advertisements are displayed. So it will unnecessarily cause disturbance. Then privacy concerns, including the collection of data about teen users. There are many people who can collect information only through these sites. If proper security settings, if proper private settings are not set, then it is very easy to collect the information about the users, especially the teen users, and post it on some porn websites or use them for such activities. Okay. Then identity theft or being hacked. Now note here that it is better to have social networking profile. If you don't have it, then there is a possibility that somebody else may create a profile on your name and they will start act like you. Okay, so it is better that you have social networking site, but use it with caution. But if you don't have it, even that will also pose some kind of risk. Then interference with sleep, exercise, homework or family activities. It is not only with the social networking sites, it is also true with the case of excessive use of gadgets, even the mobile phone, games, etc. The next is chatting. We know that there are many people who are not there on social media website, but they are at least there on WhatsApp or Telegram. Okay. Now, there are many guidelines which apply to chatting, which are true in case of emails. Now again, never open, accept or download a file in instant messaging from someone you don't know. If you don't know that person, then don't download anything from that person. Okay. Then if the file comes from someone you don't know, don't open it unless you know what the file is. Okay. Then contact the sender by email or by phone or some other method to confirm that what they sent was not a virus. Okay. Because you can hide a code in many types of files. The moment you open it, it gets activated and it will affect your device, it will affect you. Because we don't know what kind of software it is and what is the objective. Is the objective is to steal the data or the objective is to destroy the data on the system. Then visit Microsoft Update to scan your Windows computer and install any high priority updates that are offered to your PC. So it is even true in case of your mobile phones. Okay, update. Keep updating all your applications on mobile phone. Keep updating all your applications on your laptop. Keep updating operating system on mobile phone. Keep updating operating system on your laptop or a PC. Okay, because each update will be having a patch to known issue. Okay, known security bug. So they might have taken care of it and it will safeguard you at least for that known concern. Now if you have automatic updates enabled, the updates are delivered to you when they are released, but you have to make sure you install them. Okay. It is always better that you enable this option, automatic updates. So whenever there is an update, you will get a notification and you can install them. Then similarly, the concerned software patches from Linux OS also need to be updated. Okay. There are commands, there are tutorials on the internet. So you just need to follow those to update your Linux operating system. Use up-to-date version of your Instant Messenger software for better protection of your computer against viruses and spyware. So the moment you receive update for your WhatsApp Messenger, the moment you receive update for your Telegram Messenger, update it. If you are using MSN Messenger, upgrade to Windows Live Messenger, which will block attachments that might contain malware and allow you to scan attachments for viruses. So basically, update all the softwares on your PC, on your gadgets, on your mobile phones. So you are already aware that there are many instant messaging softwares, but use only those which are familiar and use only those which releases updates regularly. Now like email viruses, there's a possibility of instant message viruses. They are also malicious programs, but instead of emails, they will be shipped to instant messaging platforms. So SPIM is the short form for spam over instant messaging. So it uses platforms like WhatsApp or Telegram to send spam messages over these platforms. So like email spam messages, a SPIM message also contains advertisements. It generally contains web links. By clicking to on those links, malicious code enters into your PC. Sometimes you might have also noticed that whenever you visit a site, you get automatic pop-up which asks you to install some software, some application. But note here that that app is not from Play Store. Okay, so it is automatically loaded. So don't install any such applications. Antivirus software can help to detect and remove IM viruses from your computer only if you keep antivirus software up to date. This is very, very important. You have to keep keep the antivirus software up to date. Then if you have purchased the subscription from an antivirus software company, your antivirus software may update itself when you are connected to the internet. Anti-spyware software can help to protect your computer from spyware and remove any spyware you may already have. So sometimes these will be installed on your browser also. So you need to check the browser settings and remove these viruses. Remove these additional applications, extensions which are installed without your notice. If you don't have anti-spyware software, you can download it, or you can download the Windows Defender. It's a free software. Then next, there are some guidelines you should follow whenever you are dealing with downloading softwares. So while downloading any file, close all applications that are running on your computer. Let only one setup file run at a time of downloading. So that means you can download only, or you should download only one setup file at a time. Close all important applications in order to be safe if something goes wrong while downloading. Then set firewalls, set antivirus to actively scan all files you download. The moment you start downloading your antivirus software, it also starts scanning your download. If it sees that that particular software which you have downloaded is malicious, it will alert you. Okay, then you can decide whether to delete it or whether to continue with that file. Scan all the files after you download, whether from websites or links received from emails. Then always use updated antivirus, spam filter and spyware to help detect and remove virus. Spyware from the application you want to download. Then never download any files like music, video, games and many more from untrusted sites. And don't go by the recommendations given by your friends or made by any random website's comments. So this is very, very important. Okay, don't go by the recommendation of your friends and random websites. You should personally verify them. Check that the URLs are same and always download games, music or videos from the secure websites, like which uses HTTPS websites instead of HTTP. So in the web address, it replaces HTTP to HTTPS. The HTTP refers to Hypertext Transfer Protocol secure. So whenever you type the URL, you see there whether the lock is open or lock is closed. The lock is closed means that particular site is secure. In Google Chrome, at least you will see green tick mark saying that this site is secure. You should be very careful when you are doing financial transactions and when you are submitting any information. You should at least never submit, or you should never do any financial transactions which use only HTTP protocol. Then download anything only from trustworthy websites. Don't click links to download anything you see or unauthorized sites. So if any dirty words appear on the website, just close the window, no matter how important it is, because spyware may be installed on your PC from such websites. Then check the size of the file before you download. Sometimes it shows a very small size, but after you click, it increases the size of the file. In that case, it's a virus, so just stop the download. Never believe anything which says click on this link and your computer settings will be changed and your PC can be turned into Xbox and can play unlimited games on your computer. Okay, so basically you should be 100% sure that whatever software you are downloading, it is safe and secure. Don't accept anything that offers you free download, because that may contain malicious software. So you can go for free and open source software from trusted source. Usually the GitHub will be the trusted source, but you should also verify, because anybody can upload repository of code on the GitHub. Don't click the link or file and let it start download automatically, or download the file and save where you want, save and then run the application. The next is set secure browser settings before you download anything. So set the secure settings to highest level in your web browser. Read carefully before you click on install or run application. That means read terms and conditions. Very, very important. Don't download anything until you know complete information of the website and know whether it is an original site of an original company. Because hackers may create a similar looking website which looks exactly the same, even in the domain name it will be the exactly the same. Say for example, the official website of SBI card may look like sbicard.com, then other person or the hacker may create sbicards.com. okay, just addition of letter S or sbicard.in. okay, even the interface will be same. Okay, but the websites are different, so you should verify exactly, is it the same website, is it the legitimate website of the bank or credit card. Never download from the links that offer free antivirus or anti-spyware software. Always download from trusted sites. If you are not sure about the site you are downloading, enter the site into favorite search engine to see anyone posted or reported that it contains unwanted technologies. Then final topic of today's webinar is ATM safety tips. That is, enable your mobile phone number and email with your banking transactions for timely SMS and email alerts. Now many banks are switching from their physical credit card to mobile system. That is, you don't need credit card or debit card to withdraw the money. So if you are having mobile phone, then that's more than enough. And many bank ATMs, they are also sending OTP while withdrawing the money. So SBI is the recent addition, so which sends OTP if you are withdrawing money from their ATMs. Your financial institution or bank will never send you an email asking you to enter your banking details online. This is very very important statement. Okay, no bank will call you, no bank will send email or SMS asking for your banking information. Okay, check regularly your credit card or bank account details and keep track of your transactions. It is very very important. Keeping track of your transactions is very very important. Sometimes what happens is we configure our credit card accounts or bank accounts for standing instructions. Okay, so maybe due to bug in the system, or maybe we may forget something, or sometimes these settings are done automatically. Okay, because business people, they think only the business, so they make write at the application in such a way that your credit card may be automatically added for auto debit facility. Okay, so periodically check whether your account is set for auto debit or standing instruction. If you don't want, then just remove your credit card information from that site. Okay, the next is update your details, such as change of address for receipt of your checkbooks, statements, debit or credit cards at the right address. Otherwise it may go to old address and you may not be able to take appropriate action. For protecting phishing attacks, your browser should be enabled with phishing filters and never click links in your email for updating and transactions. Keep a strong and easy to remember password and change it regularly. Phishing is a form of phishing, where instead of people receiving an email trying to lure them into giving personal information, the criminal uses a phone call, either live or automated, to attack the bank or credit union customer and get critical information. So in phishing, what happens, these criminals will call the customers of the bank, whereas in case of phishing, these criminals will call to the bank directly to get the customer information. Okay, so it will be done, it can be done either way. Then try to restrict yourself from giving personal information when you receive a call from a bank or credit card provider. You can just simply say that I will visit the bank branch and I will provide the information there. Look for a no tampering sign. Crooks often place these to stop anyone curious about a new piece of equipment. Then steer clear of a jammed ATM machine that forces customer to use another ATM that has a skimmer attached. So often a criminal will disable other ATMs in the area to draw users to one that has the skimming device on it. So if you see that there are some ATMs which are not allowing you to withdraw the money, simply change the area, go to different area and try to withdraw the money. Customers should check their bank accounts regularly to make sure there are no unusual or unauthorized transactions. So federal law limits loss from ATM fraud and many banks offer additional protection. So customers should check with their financial institution for details. If you see anything unusual or suspicious around an ATM, or if you find unauthorized ATM transactions on your bank account, immediately notify the local law enforcement as well as your financial institution or the establishment where the ATM is located. So you may not get the remedy here with respect to the loss, because the amount you have lost may be small. Okay, even if it is a huge amount, then it may not be guaranteed. So it is better to follow these guidelines to be safe, to use ATM safely. Okay, always protect your PIN. Don't give the number to anyone. Okay, it is very, very important. If you give PIN to anyone, if somebody asks for a PIN, then you can just simply lose the money. Thank you. Yeah, there is a feedback link which is shared. So please provide your feedbacks. Yeah, I will share the link. ಸರ್ ಅದಿದು ಆಚರಿ ಇಲ್ಲ ಬಂದ್ ಆದೈತೆ ಅಲ್ರಿ ಸರ್ ಇಲ್ಲ ಗ್ರೂಪ್ ಒಳಗೆ ಹಾಕ್ಬಿಡ್ತೀರೇನು ಹಾಂ ಸೊ ಫೀಡ್ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಲಿಂಕ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಶೇರ್ಡ್ ಆನ್ ದಿ ಟೆಲಿಗ್ರಾಮ್ ಚಾನಲ್ ಸೊ ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ಫಿಲ್ ದ ಫೀಡ್ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಎವ್ರಿ ಒನ್ ಫಾರ್ ಅಟೆಂಡಿಂಗ್ ಟುಡೇಸ್ ಲೆಕ್ಚರ್ ಟುಮಾರೋ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ವಿಲ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಒನ್ ಮೋರ್ ಸೆಷನ್ ಟುಡೇ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಡಿಸ್ಕಸ್ಡ್ ವೆರಿ ಕಾಮನ್ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ಸ್ ಟುಮಾರೋ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಡಿಸ್ಕಸಿಂಗ್ ಸಮ್ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲೈಸ್ಡ್ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ಸ್ ಹೋಪ್ ಎವ್ರಿ ಒನ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಎಂಜಾಯ್ಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಸೊ ಇಫ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಗಾಟ್ ಎನಿ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್ಸ್ ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ಪೋಸ್ಟ್ ದೆಮ್ ಆನ್ ಟೆಲಿಗ್ರಾಮ್ ಚಾನಲ್ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಅಡ್ರೆಸ್ ದೋಸ್ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್ಸ್ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್ಸ್ ಮೇ ಬಿ ಟುಮಾರೋಸ್ ಲೆಕ್ಚರ್ So my battery is low. I don't know how many questions I can answer. So there's a question from Poonam Chaugle. Why hackers will give the password to the dark web? Okay. It's a criminal's mindset. They just want to earn money. So they hack the information and they hack these databases and sell it on the dark web. They earn money from it. It's the hacker's bread and butter. Then Akshay Khanapuri is asking, the website password meter is running on HTTP. The input provided to the form is not encrypted. Yeah, in that case, you can stop using it. So I don't recommend it. So it is used to just show the demonstration of checking the password strength. So in that case, you can stop using it. You can go for either Have I Been Pwned website or password.kaspersky.com. They are secured websites. Then there is one more question by Prathamesh Vadgave. What kind of precautions should be taken while using NFC enabled ATM cards? In case of NFC enabled ATM cards, actually the distance, NFC means near field communications. So in NFC they consider a distance. So the distance is limited to only few centimeters, not meters. Okay, so in that way these are secured, you can say. And they also have a limitation on the amount of transaction. Say for example, you have NFC enabled credit card. The moment you tap it to make a payment, in India the limitation is 2000 rupees. So up to 2000 rupees only you can make a payment by tapping. Okay, and it works only in the range of few